according to
glory to the Lord.
Tax collectors and sinners were all drawn near to listen to Jesus, but the Pharisees and scribes began to complain, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So to them Jesus addressed this parable. A man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, "Father, give me the share of your estate that should come to me." So the father divided the property between them. After a few days, the younger son collected all his belongings and set off to a distant country, where he squandered his inheritance on a life of dissipation. When he had freely spent everything, a severe famine struck that country, and he found himself in dire need. So he hired himself out to one of the local citizens, sent him to his farm to tend his swine. And he longed to eat his fill of the pods on which the swine fed, but nobody gave him any. Coming to his senses, he thought, "How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough to eat? But here am I, dying from hunger. I shall get up and go to my father, and I shall say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Treat me as you would treat one of your hired workers.'" So he got up and went back to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him and was filled with compassion. He ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. Son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son." But his father ordered his servants, "Quickly, bring the finest robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Take the fattened calf and slaughter it. Then let us celebrate with a feast. Because this son of mine is dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." Then the celebration began. Now the older son had been out in the field, and on his way back, as he neared the house, he heard the sound of music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what this might mean. The servant said to him, "Your brother has returned. Your father has slaughtered the fat calf because he has him back safe and sound." He became angry when he refused to enter the house. His father came out and pleaded with him. He said to his son in reply, "Look, all these years I served you, not once did I disobey your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to feast on with my friends. But when your son returns, you swallowed up the property with prostitutes. For him, you slaughtered the fat calf." He said to him, "Son, you are here with me always. Everything I have is yours. But now you must celebrate and rejoice, because your brother is dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I guess we were able to get out of the park after the rain yesterday. Thank you to God, I made it back to Rockville Center in one piece last night. Wisdom prevailed. The northern state was okay when I finally made my way down 347. I got a little hairy as I got towards Seaford Oyster Bay, but managed to get on that. I was going down to Seaford Oyster Bay. It was one of those nights when there are big puddles in the left lane, and people drive a little slower in the right lane, with all leaning back and forth. They said, "You know what? just take the extra 10 minutes that risk the Southern State, which is always here. So, thanks be to God. God made a good time. But nice to be back once again this night with all of you. Beginning just with a prayer, thanking God for the gift of this time. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of life, for the gift of faith that we have, for the opportunity to be here this evening in the midst of Lent, to be here in silence, to be here for powerful real presence of your Son, Jesus, poured out for us on the altar. Thank you in the midst of Lent for calling us to this moment of intimacy, this moment of reflection, a moment of tenderness where we acknowledge who we are before you, when we can come to know ever more deeply the great love that you have for us. Heavenly Father, we ask you with your Son to send the Holy Spirit upon us this night. Come, Holy Spirit, open our hearts and our minds. Help us to know all we wish to give, to receive it deeply. Come, Holy Spirit, the powerful intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for our sinners, now and at the hour of our death. So we know this time of commission is a time of remembering, of getting back to basics. And as I had said at the weekend, again last night, I put before myself, before you in these days, two questions just to help us focus on those basics. The first, why it is that we need Lent? How come we have to enter into these 40 days? And then secondly, the remembrance of who it is that invites us into this privileged season in the life of the Church, who invites us to undertake the prayer, the fasting, the almsgiving, to live Lent well. I, of course, relay that story of my nephew and my brother at Kennedy Airport, Nesky waffle and syrup. And through that story, able to give, I would say, a short answer as to why it is that we need Lent, because each of us in our own ways make the mess that my nephew makes and made that day. Each of us goes a little out of the lines at times. We sin, we fail through weakness, through fault, what we do and what we fail to do. Clear with ourselves about that. And we see in that story who it is that invites us. I held up the image of my brother in the moment, who was patient and understanding and just wanting the best for his son. So too, if we hold on to that, we see a heavenly Father who loves us and delights in us, who understands us, who wants ultimately something better for us, who wants us to live not mess of things or make a mess, but rather to live in him. But he is good, patient, and understanding, like my brother at that time. Those were the easy ways to put the questions before us: why we need Lent, and who it is that invites us into it. And again, the short answer is found through that simple story. Last night, as we tonight, hearing the parable of the prodigal son, brothers, the parable of the merciful Father, call it what you will. Through that, we went a little deeper into these questions. Last night, before we delved into the parable, to look especially at those two sons, two brothers, just the remembrance, so basic, of who we are. As men and women created in God's image and likeness, remembering that we are created, that we are dependent, that none of us are self-sufficient, and that all of us are ultimately, as Ash Wednesday reminds us, destined to be dust. knowing that we're endowed by God with intellect and will, that we have this beautiful desire within ourselves for the infinite, for God, for something marvelous and wonderful, and yet we're tied to our bodies and time. We live in this tension between the great call to live with Him and the reality that right now I'm just tired. My passion is getting better with me, and I react in a way that I wouldn't want to. This tension of how it is that we fill ourselves, how it is that we move through life. That's the simplistic way of saying who we are as men and women. But holding on to that is so important, because knowing the tension, knowing the desire that we have for something wonderful, and knowing the ways to ourselves that it's fulfilled the times of this life, everything is just wonderful, great, it all lines up. And knowing too those moments when it all can fall flat because of ourselves, our proclivity to sin. Knowing that, we see the drama of life. And things again become sensible, understandable to us. And it's in that we can enter into power and to see those brothers. And it becomes understandable again, in a way, to see how it is that things can go awry in our lives. The younger brother, as we said last night, there with the father, being in his house, everything ordered, everything right, getting up at the set time, working the full day, making meals together, living a life that was disciplined and good, just following the order of the father's house, but yet not enough, longing for something more, and thinking that he would find it in his life where he squanders the inheritance. He goes far away from home, but ultimately, desiring to return to his father, finding there what he ultimately was looking for. The tension, the drama within the heart of that younger son, again, familiar to us. And then the tension of the older son as well within his heart, thinking he would find the fulfillment that the ape would make sense by doing things dutifully, by doing everything that was asked of him by the father, but as we see, ultimately doing things without love, because at the end, when the younger brother returns, he should be filled with joy that the one who was dead has come to life again. He is not joyful, but rather angry. He's resentful, because I've done all that I was supposed to do. Tension, longing for something more, knowing perhaps where it should be found, but taking these paths which lead us a place of anger or destruction. Again, both sons, familiar to us because in our own lives, in our own ways, our own hate, our own longing, not always fulfilled where it should be in our relationship with the Lord, rather other places that ultimately fall short and are empty. So in seeing those two sons, two brothers, see clearly again why it is that we enter into Lent, as we see ourselves and we realize that we need to grow. We need to turn from ourselves, from our ways, and turn back to God. That's why it is we enter into Lent. Who invites us? Well, yes, the God who is understanding, and patient, and kind, and passionate, and merciful. God is pleased when we turn back to Him. Of course, we see that in the merciful Father this evening in the parable. A Father who loves us and respects us. And at the beginning of the parable, shows Himself to be incredibly generous with us. The younger son, as we say, approaches the father and asks for his share of the inheritance. It's pretty clear what has happened here. Father, I wish that you weren't here any longer. I wish that now, at this moment, you were dead, so that I could have what I would want, and I could go and do as I please. Father, of course, would have rebuilt it and say, no. What's mine is mine, and you're not getting it. Maybe literally over my dead body. But the Father gives his younger son the share that was his. And he allows him to go off, and with the wisdom of the parents, probably knowing what he would do, knowing that it would be spent freely and quickly. But yet he's generous. He gives and he respects. He lets the son go his way. For us, in reflecting upon the goodness of the Father, yes, and merciful and compassionate, the first thing to see and remember is that it is by God's gift that we even have the opportunity to go astray. Because he loves us so much that he wants us to have freedom within us. The freedom to choose him or not. And that is an incredible telling of the God who is ours. He respects our freedom after giving it to us. He does not coerce us towards himself. So, this disclosure of the Father, this gift. But of course, the beauty of the Father comes into full relief when we see the younger son having received the gift and gone off and spent it freely. When we see that younger son return back to the Father and the Father's house. The younger son, I love the phrase, coming to his senses. There as he's with the pigs, envious of their food, who sets back to the house, saying to himself, you know, at the very least, I know that my dad's a good man, he's just, he treats his servants well, his hired workers, and if he would hire me back as one of them, then I'd be in a good place, better where I'm at now. The younger son not even thinking of the possibility of regaining his sonship, just looking for a good employer. So the younger son sets back. What do we hear in the gospel? The younger son, while he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him. This wasn't the father sitting in his house, going over the accounts. It wasn't a father who was caught up in himself after a day's work. Before the day didn't start, it was a father who saw the potential of his son. No matter how far he had gone, how distant he had gone off into that country, he knew the potential, the possibility that the freedom that he had been given and was being misused could one day be used rightly. That the son could turn around, that he could come to his senses and start over. And because of that, because he knew the potential and the possibility, the father was willing to look for him day in and day out. While he was still a long way off, the father caught sight of him. You can almost imagine the son, his head down, thinking to himself as he walked a familiar path back to his father's house, that saying that was his, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, I no longer deserve to be called your son. Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, I no longer deserve to be called your son. Let me repeat it again and again, because soon I'll be before him. I want to make sure I say it. Every word just right. The son not even looking as the father sees him. And then the verbs are important. The father runs to his son. He's intensely interested in him, waiting for him day in and day out. And finally, when he appears, he can't be held back. I imagine my own father. Father Greg knows. As Father Greg would say, not a tiny guy. But I can imagine my own dad running, which seems almost absurd, but a desire just to forget any ailments, anything that would hold them back, because the joy is so great in his heart of this father to be near to his son. So he runs with him, and he embraces him. He doesn't wait for the son to give his speech that's so well rehearsed about the sinning that he's done against heaven and against him, and that he's no longer deserving to be called a son. Rather, he embraces him, and he kisses him. The mercy, the compassion, the kindness, the patience, the understanding, all of it in that moment. Power. And then the father, not content to let this be between him and his son, calls everyone in. Bring the finest robe and put it on him. Don't bring the servants down, but bring a robe fitting of my son, because his dignity has been restored. He's back. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. He looks different, literally, in his vesture because of what the Father has bestowed upon him. Forgiveness, mercy, and his sonship once more. You're not going to be working with the others. You are my son, and you have a place in this that is unlike them. And then they celebrate with a feast. Bring the fattened calf and slaughter. My son was dead, and now he has life. He was lost, and now he's found. In those few verses in St. Luke, he lay on the Lord's words. He tells us of the great glory of the Father, who is our Father. Father shows himself, of course, once more to power, and acts with the older son in jealousy and envy that he has. He who is dutiful and does everything he's supposed to do never causes any trouble for his father. The father, when he hears that the son is outside, stewing in his anger, goes out to meet him. He doesn't wait for the son to come in. This is a father who looks for the son who's been lost, who understands the situation of the older son who's envious and jealous. Let me go out to him. Let me make the first move. Let me bump up against him in his life. And after the son says to the father why he is angry, Father gives that most beautiful line. You're here with me always. Yes, I see it. I know it. I love it. I'm grateful for it. Everything I have is yours. Not half the inheritance, all of it. Take it. Everything is yours. We can almost hear him say, though his love is too good to say, but you never ask. Everything is yours. A father who is generous in giving, freedom, in loving and respecting. A father who is generous, lavish, in bestowing that mercy and kindness upon us. And a father who shares everything desires to hold back. That's the God who gives us the gift of land, and the God who waits for us on the other side. He's with us, of course, in the midst of it, but he waits especially for us at Easter, so that the resurrection of his Son can be given to us, bestowed upon us. How good it is not simply to see Lent as a dutiful thing, the praying and the fasting and the almsgiving, but to see it as something that I must worthily enter into, because I am needed, because I've chosen things that don't fill my heart completely. I've chosen things other than God, and I must be purified of them, so that my longing, desire for something more, for the greatest thing, is found only in Him. And how great it is to see Lent in that fashion, knowing who it is that invites us into. This God who is beautifully told of in the parable. I'd be remiss in the season of Lent not to give a moment in sacrament of confession and reconciliation, because it is maybe the sacrament, we might say, of it. So many opportunities to go to confession in parishes throughout the season, and then throughout the diocese here, Rockville Center, Brooklyn, and the Archdiocese of New York, March 25th this year, once again, Reconciliation Monday, an invitation to Catholics all throughout downstate, the metropolitan area, to go back to the Lord, to meet Him once more, to meet this Father who is merciful. The sacrament of reconciliation is where the parable is lived. It comes to life once more. Every time we enter into the sacrament, when we humble ourselves, having prepared ourselves well, examined our conscience, we go before the priest. We are the younger son returning home, back to the Father, who waits for us, who's patient, and who, having heard the sin, is generous in bestowing forgiveness. So, in these days of Lent, in this time of returning to the Father, we put before ourselves the sacrament once more, and we ask God for grace to humble ourselves and to go back with a renewed appreciation. If it's been only a week, for a month, or a year, or 10 years, or more. However, just to head back, so that the God who longs for us, He desires us, can meet us, so He can catch sight of us, full of compassion, embrace us, kiss us, put the robe upon us, ring on our finger, and sandals upon our feet, and then give us once more the great banquet of the Eucharist.
Jesus Christ, who gave us you, as the memorial of your suffering and death. May our worship of the sacrament of your body and blood help us to experience the salvation you won for us, and the peace of the kingdom, where you live with the Father and the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Even until the end of time. Amen.